Warfarin is a well-known anticoagulant. Warfarin inhibits production of vitamin K-dependent proteins, and we all know that warfarin has anticoagulant properties because warfarin inhibits production of vitamin K-dependent clotting factors as factor 2, 7, 9, and 10. But also warfarin inhibits production of natural anticoagulant proteins as protein C and protein S. The function of protein C is to neutralize factors 5 and 8. Also, protein C increases the rate of fibrinolysis, and protein S functions as cofactor of protein C. So these two proteins function as antagonists to procoagulant factors, and by this they keep coagulation system in balance. And for now we certainly know that warfarin in the first 36 hours creates a transient hypercoagulable state that significantly increases the risk of various thrombotic complications. The reason why warfarin creates transient hypercoagulable state is that warfarin causes decrease in protein C activity faster than it decreases the activity of procoagulant factors. To explain this, it's liver tissue where protein C and procoagulant factors are produced. In the blood there are factors 2, 9, 10 and also protein C. And when patient takes warfarin, warfarin disrupts synthesis of vitamin K-dependent proteins. Basically, warfarin alters their synthesis in the liver tissue, and as a result, liver begin to produce broken vitamin K-dependent proteins. So warfarin makes them ineffective. But very important that warfarin does not affect the structure of already synthesized proteins that are already present in the blood. Warfarin acts only on production of these proteins. And to understand how warfarin affects coagulation, we have to know that all coagulation factors and anticoagulant proteins have different periods of half-life, which is the period that they exist in the circulation, or basically we can say is a period of their life in the circulation. For example, protein C is a short-lived protein with a half-life of approximately 8 hours. But what we have to know is that warfarin acts only on synthesis of coagulation factors, but it has no effect on the functional state of factors that are already synthesized and present in the blood. So when patient intake warfarin, we can divide this picture in two. The functional state of factors and proteins that were produced before warfarin remains unchanged, and the factors that liver will produce will be broken. So we can say that warfarin has no effect on past, warfarin affects on the future. So let's take protein C, which is the major anticoagulant protein, and three major procoagulant proteins, its factor 9, 10 and 2. The half-life of protein C is 8 hours. In contrast to this, the period of life of coagulative factors is much longer. Factor 9, 24 hours, factor 10, 46 hours, factor 2, 60 hours. So let's assume that person consumed a lot of warfarin pills, and now he has warfarin intoxication, so from this point liver produce only ineffective vitamin K-dependent proteins. So warfarin disrupts synthesis of vitamin K-dependent proteins in the liver tissue. So we can say that the production of pro- and anticoagulative proteins from this point is stopped. But because warfarin do not affect proteins that are already present in the circulation, we have to understand that warfarin effect will be observed only when previously synthesized normal proteins that are already present in the circulation will disappear. So now everything depends on how long already synthesized proteins will exist in the circulation, or more precisely, how long is their half-life. The half-life of protein C is 8 hours, and after 8 hours there will be no normal protein C in the blood, just broken protein C that do not have anticoagulant activity. But procoagulative proteins as factor 9, 10 and 2 will be present, and this creates so-called transient procoagulative state. And this procoagulative state will last approximately 36 hours. To explain why, recall that intrinsic coagulation pathway and extrinsic pathway, they both result in activation of factor 10. And factor 10 is a central enzyme and the most crucial enzyme in coagulation cascade. Then activated factor 10 converts prothrombin into thrombin, and thrombin converts fibrinogen into fibrin, that finally results in clot formation. So basically factor 10 is the crucial procoagulative protein, and without factor 10, the risk of thrombotic complications will be substantially lower. So everything depends on how long factor 10 exists in the circulation, and the half-life of factor 10 is approximately 46 hours. and 46 minus 8 and minus 2, which is the approximate period of warfarin absorption and the initial metabolism, is 36 hours. So that's why the time period of approximately 36 hours after initial warfarin intake is considered as a period of the highest risk of thrombotic complications. And during this time period, the activity of procoagulative proteins substantially prevails over anticoagulant proteins, and this transient hypercoagulable state can lead to a massive thrombosis. And one of the potential complications is warfarin-induced skin necrosis. The mechanism is that thrombi are usually formed in microvasculature, usually in capillaries and venules. And thrombotic occlusions of the microvasculature results in necrosis of the subcutaneous fat. Most commonly it affects extremities, but also it can develop on breast, trunk and penis. If left untreated, affected areas become edematous, then purpuric, and then tissue necrosis develops that potentially can lead to a gangrene. Also, thrombosis in the venous blood vessels can occur, and in this case potentially it can cause venous thromboembolism. So warfarin can cause skin necrosis and venous thromboembolism. And we have one category of patients with an abnormally high risk of warfarin-induced skin necrosis. It's a patients with a hereditary protein C deficiency. These patients have the highest risk of warfarin-induced skin necrosis because they already have low protein C level. So in this case, even minimal dose of warfarin in 8 hours will cause protein C depleted state with a significantly higher risk of thrombotic complications. And treatment includes immediate cessation of warfarin and administration of protein C concentrate to restore protein C level. Extremely high yield to know that to prevent thrombotic complications when we start warfarin therapy, in addition to warfarin, we add heparin. Because heparin activates antithrombin 3, which inactivates all these coagulative factors. Thereby, antithrombin 3 keeps coagulation system in balance. Well, to be fair, warfarin-induced skin necrosis is not the most frequent complication that you will see in clinical practice, unless there will be an epidemic of warfarin intoxications. But this topic is very frequently tested on exams.